Hello friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of 10th November 2018. The articles we'll be seeing today are these 8. First one we'll be seeing about Cube satellite. Second one talks about the tribals in India called as Lambada tribes. Third one talks about China's new multi-dollar strategic port in the country of Myanmar. Fourth one talks about the naval exercise of Simbex. Fifth one is about e-codes. And the sixth one talks about the Operation Green. And seventh article talks about National Judicial Data Grid. And eighth one is about Central Groundwater Authority. So the first topic for the day is about Cube satellites. So what are these Cube satellites? So the Cube satellites, they come under a class of nano satellites. So that is, they are very much small in size as well as in weight. They are made of very few components, that is the basic components which are necessary for their efficient survival. They include an antenna, a computer, a power source to power the satellite, and an instrument to conduct various scientific experiments out in space. So the Cube satellites, they are measured in the size of one unit. So ideally one unit is 10 into 10 into 10 centimeters, and they are extendable in the multiples of 1.53 till 12 units. So what are the advantages of using the Cube satellites? One of the major advantage of Cube satellites is because of their low cost. So since they are built with very small size as well as weight, they are cost efficient and they can be built rapidly with lesser time to conduct various simple technology experiments out in space. So apart from scientific technology demonstration, they're also used to conduct scientific research, educational projects, as well as few commercial projects out there in space. Normally, the Cube satellites are placed in low Earth orbit. Low Earth orbit, they span from 160 kilometers to 2000 kilometers from the surface of Earth. The currently functioning Cube satellites are placed in low Earth orbit at about 400 kilometers from the surface of Earth. So this Cube satellites was in news because of a Cube satellite called as BioSentinel of NASA. So this BioSentinel mission is a low cost mission. It was basically designed to study deep space radiation technology using yeast. The second article we'll be seeing today is about Lambada tribes. So this Lambada tribe, they are one of the oldest tribal groups in India. And this Lambada tribes are present in different parts of India, including the states of Rajasthan, Telangana and Andhra Pradesh. And in different parts of India, they are known with different names. Some of the names for these Lambada tribes include Banjaras, Boiparis, Sugali, Lambini, Lambani, etc. Different historians, they give different ideas for the origin of this tribe. So according to one of them, these Banjara tribes are tend to be the descendants of the cattle rearers of Lord Krishna. But according to other sources, they are migrants from various parts of the world, including Persia, European countries, and even from Middle East, North Africa, or even from Russia. So every tribe has a unique language, and the tribal community is identified by the language. So this tribal community, that is the Lambada tribe, they speak a specific language called as Ghos, and thus their name, Ghor community for the Lambada tribes. So as per the census of 2011, in the state of Andhra Pradesh alone, there are about 5.5 million Lambada tribes living currently. So apart from Lambada tribes, there are other dominant tribal groups in the state of Telangana. Some of them include Koyas, Gons, Yerukalas and Pradans. The third article we'll be seeing today is China clinches multi-billion dollar strategic port deal with Myanmar. As we all know, China has increasing its sphere of influence via its One Belt, One Road project. China is also increasing its sphere of influence, particularly in Indian Ocean region, so via the project of String of Pearls. So this String of Pearls project is mainly aimed to neutralize the effect of India in Indian Ocean region. So as per this plan, China has been constructing various ports in different countries in Indian Ocean region. So in Pakistan, it is constructing Gwadar port, and in the state of Sri Lanka, it is constructing a port in a place called as Hambantota. So in the same lines, China is now building a multi-billion dollar project in the state of Myanmar in a place called as Kwapyu. 70% of the project will be funded by China and the remaining 30% will be funded by the government of Myanmar. So one of the strategic significance of this Chinese mission is it is geographically closely related to a place called as Sitwe, where India and Myanmar are jointly developing a port facility. So this Sitwe port is aimed to increase the connectivity between the mainland India and northeastern part of India. The fourth article we'll be seeing today is a naval exercise of Simbex. So this Simbex is a naval exercise between India and the Navy of Singapore. And this is an annual exercise which has been conducted in between the two countries since the year 1994. This year 2018, it marks the 25th edition of Simbex, that is the Silver Jubilee year of the naval exercise between India and Singapore. Usually the exercise is conducted either in Andaman Sea or the Bay of Bengal. So initially Simbex was conceptualized to increase the coordination between the two countries in anti-submarine warfare. But however, this exercise has been evolved to include other elements also, like maritime security, anti-air and anti-surface warfare. So relationship between this exercise is one of the parts to enhance the. So this Simbex naval exercise is aimed to complement India's Act East policy with Singapore. And it is also to be noted that India and Singapore share a strategic partnership since the year 2015. So for the prelims exam, UPSC asks questions related to name of the defense exercises, participating countries and the nature of exercises. So it is important for one to know the names of exercises for the prelims exam. The next article we'll be seeing is with respect to Operation Greens. So this Operation Greens is a specific program under Ministry of Food Processing. This scheme was inaugurated in budget 2018 and 19. One of the main important aspirations of the scheme is to enhance the agriculture and rural economy in India. So this scheme was conceptualized on the lines of Operation Flood, which was aimed to enhance the productivity of milk in India. So this Operation Greens is mainly aimed to address the price volatility of the perishable commodities. So initially the Operation Green is launched for three main highly used perishable commodities, that is potato, tomato and onion. And in future it is expected to be extended to other perishable commodities as well. So via this Operation Green, there will be increased promotion of farmer production organizations, agricultural logistics, as well as processing facilities in various parts of India. So in order to efficiently implement the Operation Green scheme, the government has come up with other programs to support the scheme. One such initiation is specialized agro-processing financial institution in order to make available easy credit facilities to the food processing industries. The second important offer made is the promotion of cluster-based development of agri-commodities. So this cluster-based development is done in cooperation with Ministry of Agriculture as well as Ministry of Commerce. So by doing this cluster-based development, employment opportunities will increase, as well as it also promotes the export of Indian perishable goods. 100% income tax deduction from profit is also ensured so that the profitability of farmers increases. So the government also plans to set up state-of-art testing facilities in 42 mega food parks in India in order to ensure the quality of the food products in India. So what are the main purpose benefits of this Operation Green? As I said before, onion, tomato and potato are the most highly used perishable commodities in India. And hence they are also the most grown perishable crops in India. So hence by promoting the growth of these three products, it will definitely have a positive effect on doubling the farmers' income by the end of 2022. Apart from improving the lives of farmers, this program will also promote the farmer producing organization, the logistics related to agriculture in India, as well as the processing facilities in various parts of India, which will in turn increase the trade potential of India. The next article we'll be seeing is about e-courts. As we all know, two important problems faced by Indian judicial system is number one is increased pendency of cases, and second one is improper dissemination of information between various levels of Indian judiciary, that is between high courts and the lower courts. There are about 2.7 crores of pending cases in the subordinate courts and about 1.5 lakh pending cases in the high courts of India. This e-court project has been launched to provide solution to this problem. So it is a mission mode pan-India project which comes under direct funding of Department of Justice of Ministry of Law and Justice, Government of India. So this e-court project has two main aims. Number one is to increase the computerization, thereby providing easy services to the litigants, lawyers as well as the judiciary. Number second is providing easy delivery of e-services with upgraded use of information and communication technology. So how will these objectives be achieved in this mission mode project? The main tool for achieving them is by using information and communication technology, which will put in place adequate modern hardware to increase the connectivity between the different levels of judiciary. This will in turn increase the automation, thus reducing the pendency of cases in India. Under this project, there is a submission called as National Judicial Data Grid, which will digitally connect all the courts of India. Citizen-centric services like e-filing of complaints, e-payment of fees to the judiciary, as well as mobile applications in all the courts is made available for easy dissemination of information to the litigants. So this slide talks about National Judicial Data Grid. As we saw before, this National Judicial Data Grid is a part of ongoing larger mission, that is e-court integrated mission mode project. So what is the purpose of this Judicial Data Grid? So it is a main tool to identify the cases which are pending in various parts of the judiciary, thereby providing a tool to manage the cases, which will in turn reduce the pendency of cases in different levels of judiciary. So as we all know, for any public policy making, a basic prerequisite is availability of data. And this data in case of judiciary is made available to this integrated National Judicial Data Grid. So once data is available on a publicly accessible pan-India data grid like National Judicial Data Grid, it will be easy to monitor the court performance, which will in turn address the systemic bottlenecks in different parts of functioning of judiciary, which will in turn result in efficiency of services offered by the judicial system in India. And this National Judicial Data Grid is a pan-India grid, and it will cover all categories of cases, that is civil cases as well as criminal cases. So as per the data available on eTAL, which is a statistic platform accessing the central and the state level e-governance program, so it is said that number of electronic transactions under the e-court project is on rise, and it has even reached more than 40 crores. Thus, this project will help in promoting fair and timely justice to Indian citizens. So the final article we'll be seeing is about Central Groundwater Authority. So 85% of India faces some form of water crisis. 70% of Indian groundwater system is contaminated in some form. And India ranks at a position of 121 out of 123 countries in water quality index. So these statistics, it shows the poor quality of groundwater management in our country. So, in order to regulate and control the development of groundwater management, there is a specific specialized body called the Central Groundwater Authority in India. So, this body has been constituted under the provisions of Environment Protection Act of 1986. So, the main vision of this body is to sustainably develop and manage the groundwater resources in India. So, as we all know, groundwater is a public good. Thus, the proper utilization of this scarce public good of water is very much necessary in order to achieve economic and ecological efficiency, thus providing equity to all sections of Indian citizens. So, in order to achieve these objectives, the Central Groundwater Authority has been mandated to develop and disseminate technologies to conserve groundwater and also to monitor and implement various national policies in relation to the groundwater, thus achieving a sustainable development and management of groundwater resources in India. Thank you.